بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا فما بعد My brothers and sisters, I remember our Shaykh, Shaykh Wissam Abdul Baqi, Hafizahullah, used to say that if there is one surah that we must make fard on every Muslim to memorize, that is Suratul Hujurat. Because Suratul Hujurat has so many beautiful lessons and so many directions for people on how to live Islam. Alhamdulillah, this is, I think, very, very good advice. To read the surah, to study the surah, to memorize the surah, and to constantly remind ourselves of what the akhlaq of the ummati should be. That's why when I wrote this book, I called it Akhlaq of the Ummati, because today, whether we like it or not, the fact is that you and I are representatives of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I'm saying whether you like it or not, because you know, we like to be representatives in the good aspect of it, meaning the honor of it. But sometimes we forget the burden of responsibility that falls on the person who is the representative of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I won't say somebody like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because there is nobody like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now I'm saying you, whether you like it or not, because this is how the world has chosen to define us. Many times we complain and we hear these complaints. People say, why do people see things in terms of Muslim terms? If a Muslim man or woman does something wrong, why don't people just say that, you know, Zaid did this or Fatima did this? Why must they say a Muslim did this? But if we reflect and see the example from the seerah and from the lives of the Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajmain, the Sahaba's attitude was the opposite. They would say, Kunu mithlana, they would say, become like us. They saw themselves as representatives of Islam and they lived their lives like representatives of Islam. And they told people, you want to know, somebody says, teach me about Islam. They say, look at me. Teach me the business principles of Islam. And if you ask this to a Sahabi who was a business person, he would perhaps tell you, come and sit in my shop. Come and see my business. You want to know the principles of doing business in Islam? He won't send you to an MBA college. He would say, come and look at my business. Please come and study my business. If the person says, teach me the rules of, teach me the Islamic principles of a marriage, he would say, come and see, what happens in my home. How must I bring up my children? Look at my children. Now, this is the beauty of Islam, which is that Islam is the name of a practice. Islam is not the name of a theory. Islam is not the name of a philosophy. Islam is not even the name of a theology by itself. It is the name of a practice. And like all practices, Islam benefits the one who practices it, not only the one who knows about it. I give this example all the time because it's an easy example to understand. If I became the world's most knowledgeable person, the world's greatest scholar on judo, and if I wrote 20 books on judo, and I know everything about judo, right, its history, where it started, who started it, what was the name of the person who started it, his whole lineage, who was his father, who was his grandfather, all the circumstances that led to this person inventing this martial art called judo. If I know all the physics of the angles of throws, where the fulcrum is applied, the principles of leverage that lead to the throws in judo, I may know all of this. But believe me, if I have actually not learnt and practiced judo in a dojo under a judo teacher, then if I go onto the street and somebody attacks me, Even though I am the world's greatest expert on judo, I will be flat on my back in 1 minute. My knowledge about judo will not help me. All the books that I wrote about judo will not help me if I do not practice judo. And how does the practice of judo start? Ask me, because I have practiced judo, I have practiced aikido, both. It starts by learning how to fall. What is the first thing they do to you when you go to the judo? They throw you. You fall and you fall and you fall and you fall, and you learn how to fall without hurting yourself, and only then do you get to the stage where they teach you how to throw. That is the situation with Islam. If you want to benefit from Islam, you have to practice Islam. Just knowing about Islam doesn't help. So should we not know about Islam? Of course you must know about Islam. You cannot practice Islam unless you know about Islam. You cannot practice judo unless you know about judo. But if our effort stops with knowing about, and it does not go from knowing about to practicing, then just the knowing about is worthless. It will not help us. So it's extremely important for us to focus on practicing what we are learning. If there is a name for Surah Al-Hujurat that suits it, it would be Surah Al-Ummah. It is the surah which has priceless instructions about building a community and keeping it together, while honoring all kinds of diversity. This is one of our biggest issues today, which is that we are split into divisions and into all kinds of things. And we all say, well, you know what to do? We are so diverse. We have people today. Islam has spread all over the world. That is the good news. The bad news is that because Islam spread all over the world, the Muslims have now acquired customs and practices and cultures from all kinds of places, and therefore this has resulted in divisions. The thing I want to remind you and myself is that was the exact situation even at the time of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Muslim community at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was a very diverse community. There were people of different races, there were people of different cultures, there were people who spoke different languages, yet Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was able to forge a single unit which was based on a brotherhood of faith. Now, how did he do that? What are the principles and rules of that? We learn from this surah. And that is the whole issue of akhlaq of the ummati. In our world today, this is a huge challenge. And one of the factors which is critical to our success as leaders, to be able to forge a unit from people in it who are diverse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in these ayat of Surah Al-Hujurat something which is a terminal illness, so to speak, with respect to building the ummah. So we are starting from what not to do before we go to what to do, because if we can block the things that destroy the ummah, then inshallah the ummah will be safe irrespective of whatever else we do. Even if we are not too strong about building, as long as we are stopping the forces of destruction, we are on to a good thing. Now, what I'm going to tell you is something which destroys all the good work of bringing hearts together. As surely as the hidden work of termites in the massive beams of a roof will suddenly bring it down on the heads of the occupants of that house. This is such a major danger that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explained it with a very graphic example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِّسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُنَّ
ولا تلمزوا أنفسكم ولا تنابزوا بالألقاب بئس الاسم الفسوق بعد الإيمان ومن لم يتب فأولئك هم الظالمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن إن بعض الظن إثم ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله التواب الرحيم.
الله سبحانه وتعالى said, which means, O you who believe, let not one group of you mock another group. Let not one group of you make fun of or mock another group. It may be that the latter, the second group, are better than the former. The ones who are being mocked, it is possible that in the sight of Allah, they are better than the people who are mocking them. Nor let some women mock other women. It may be that the latter are better than the former. Nor should you defame one another, nor should you insult one another by bad nicknames. How bad is it that you insult your brother after having faith? How bad is it to insult one's brother after having faith? And whosoever does not repent, then such indeed are the transgressors, they are the zalimun. And then Allah said, O you who believe, avoid suspicion, don't suspect people. Indeed, some suspicions are sins. And don't spy and don't backbite one another. Would one of you like to eat the flesh of his dead brother? Surely you would hate it. So hate backbiting. And fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's anger. Fear Allah. Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who accepts repentance and is the most merciful. My brothers and sisters, it's very, very critical that we understand this whole issue of backbiting, the whole issue of calling people names, the whole issue of criticizing one another, mocking one another. May Allah protect us. Today, the another big issue is pronouncing takfir, right? Saying that so-and-so is a kafir, so-and-so is not a Muslim, as if we can go into their hearts to see whether there is faith or not. There's a famous incident in the seerah where in one ghazwa, in one sariya actually, in one battle, Usama bin Zaid radiallahu anhu, who was like the grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, he was the son of Zaid bin Haritha radiallahu anhu, who Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had called Zaid bin Muhammad until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibited adoption, as in giving your name to an adopted child. Islam does not prevent you from taking care of orphans, but you can't give them your name. Their biological parents have rights, and their biological parents' name is what they will carry. And also, if you are raising somebody, that child does not become your child, that child does not inherit from you. If you need to give that child something, you have to give during your lifetime. If you have some other children along with that child, then at the time when you die, there is no inheritance for the adopted child, so-called adopted child, and your property and wealth will go only to your natural biological children. This is on a side note, just so that we clear this. So, Usama bin Zaid radiallahu anhu, in one battle, he was fighting, he saw a man who he had personal enmity with that man. I mean, these two, not only were they on two sides of the, in this battle, but also this particular person, for whatever reason, Allah knows best, that person and Usama bin Zaid were enemies. They did not like each other. But when the clash was happening or about to happen, that man said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. That man accepted Islam. He called out and he said, I believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Usama bin Zaid radiallahu anhu, despite that, killed the man. Now other people also saw this. So they came, and when they came back, they complained to Rasulullah sallam, and they said that Usama killed a man who had accepted Islam. Now obviously that is something which is prohibited. Even in the battle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this very clear, that if somebody comes on your side, accept Islam means what? He has come to your side. If he does that, then you protect him. You can't kill him. Now this happened, and this happened because Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu didn't like the man. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam summoned him, he called him. I'm talking about pronouncing takfir, calling somebody kafir, and then saying that, oh, but you know this, that, and so on, and we justify our wrong action. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam called Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu, and he asked him, he said, what is this? This is what I hear, that you killed a man who had declared the shahada. Usama bin Zayd radiallahu anhu spontaneously said, yeah, Rasulullah, he did that only to escape death. That was not in his heart. He didn't do that sincerely. He did that only to escape. Rasulullah's blessed face became red with anger. Rasulullah said to Usama bin Zayd, you opened his chest to see whether there was iman? Did you open his chest to see whether there was sincerity? Now think about this. When we pronounce takfir on somebody, and may Allah protect us, there are people in the Muslims are doing this all the time. Right? Whichever group you belong to, you point to somebody else, some other group, and you say they are not Muslim, this, that. I am not saying that every practice that everybody is doing is right. No. There are wrong practices. The correct practice is what Rasulullah ﷺ and his Sahaba did. There is no doubt about this, that Nabi ﷺ did not bring multiple flavors of Islam. Rasulullah ﷺ brought one religion, and that one religion is Islam. And how that religion is to be practiced and lived by, the finest example is the life of Rasulullah ﷺ himself and the lives of his Sahaba Ridwanullahi alayhim ajmain, who he taught, who learned from him. What they did is correct. What anyone else does will be correct, provided it tallies with what Rasulullah ﷺ did. And if it does not tally, it doesn't matter who that person is. We do not follow that person. We follow Rasulullah ﷺ. There is no doubt about this. However, to criticize somebody else who is Muslim. Now you might say, well, you know, if they are doing these practices, they are not Muslim, they have left Islam. Let me remind you of the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ. They asked him, they said, ya Rasulullah, who is a Muslim? Rasulullah ﷺ said, the one who said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. He said, the one who said, la ilaha illallah, who prays in the direction of our Kaaba, and who eats what we slaughter. Just three things. Right? The boundary of Islam. Somebody who believes in the Shahada, who has taken the Shahada, who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and who demonstrates that belief by salah. That the person prays. And he prays in the direction of our Kaaba. He is not praying in some other direction. And that person eats what we slaughter, which means that he is part of the Muslim Brotherhood. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that person is a Muslim. Now whatever else he might be doing, supposing he is doing these three things, but he is also drinking alcohol, he is also doing something, he also has, you know, interest-based transactions, banking transactions, maybe he is going and, you know, to some grave, and he is... apparently, because of what we see, we don't know what is in his heart. You see him, you know, standing at the grave with his hands like this or something. What not? I'm not saying all of these practices are right. They are not right. What is not correct is not correct. But do I have or do you have a right to pronounce takfir on that person? Do you have a right to say he or she is not a Muslim? No, we do not have this right. Please, let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decide who is a Muslim, who is a non-Muslim. As far as we are concerned, as long as the person said, la ilaha illallah, as long as the person is praying, as long as the person eats what we slaughter, he is a Muslim, she is a Muslim, they are our brothers and sisters. If we have a problem with anything that they do, let us go talk to them, let us sit with them, let us make friends with them, let us be nice to them. Do not pronounce takfir, do not criticize them, do not definitely backbite them, don't mock them, don't give them nasty names. All of this Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prohibited. The asbab al-nuzul, circumstances of revelation of these two ayat of Surah Al-Hujurat 11 and 12, They are related in two incidents, one concerning Thabit bin Qais bin Shammas, who was hard of hearing and he used to sit next to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. One day he came late and then he started to step over the people to get close to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he called out, "Move, move, move." Someone told him, "Sit down where you are. There is a place there." So he cursed that man. He reviled that man and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala revealed these ayats. Right? He got angry and he cursed the man. And also the circumstances of revelation, they refer to an incident where our mothers Aisha and Hafsa radiallahu anhuma, they made fun of Umm Salama radiallahu anha because she was short, and others made fun of Safiya bint Huyay bint Akhtab radiallahu anha because she was ethnically Jewish. She complained to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and he said, "You should have told them that my father is Harun, my uncle is Musa, and my husband is Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam." So, you know, he gave her an answer which comforted her. Now, people also complained to Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that others were calling them by derogatory names. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala then revealed these ayat, and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala knows best. My brothers and sisters, what is the result of suspicion which Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala forbade us from having and he called it a sin? What is the result of being so eager to believe the worst about our brothers and sisters and so reluctant to change that opinion no matter how much evidence is produced to show that you were wrong? This is the cause of the terminal illness of the heart, and I refer to this terminal illness which is called ghibat, backbiting, and all its branches, which is buhtan, which is slander, and namima, which is innuendo. May Allah protect us from this. My brothers and sisters, please remember and understand that this is like literally from the perspective of the brotherhood of the faith. This is, as I mentioned, this is like the like termites. It eats up from inside, from within. Right? Eats up from within. And you don't even know that until the whole building collapses on top of our heads. So let us be, let us look at this thing and be very serious about this. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala began this ayat by warning us to remember the basis of our brotherhood, which is faith in Him and worshipping Him alone, as He alone is worthy of worship. So Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala prohibited people from mocking one another and laughing at one another. Laughing with one another is good. It's good humor. We should all laugh together. But laughing at yourself is very important, because otherwise we take ourselves too seriously and that is bad. But laughing at people, this is haram. Laughing at one another, this is not a good thing. To mock somebody, especially a believer, is clearly prohibited in this ayah. Let us reflect on why mocking is prohibited so emphatically. Because mocking is the result of arrogance. You only mock those you look down on and consider yourself to be superior. This is the surest way to enter Jahannam. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said in a hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, "He who has in his heart the weight of a mustard seed of pride, of arrogance, shall not enter Jannah." He said a person among his hearers who were listening to him, they said, "Verily a person loves that his dress should be good and his shoes should be good," and so on. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Verily Allah is graceful and He loves grace." Yeah, Allahu Jamilun wa Hubbul Jamal. Pride is to look down on people. It is to disdain the truth out of conceit and to have contempt for the people, and this is in Sahih Muslim. I ask you and I remind myself, let us be very clear and let us look at how we behave and what we do, and let us keep very, very far from arrogance, from looking down on others, and from mocking people, from making fun of people, from giving them bad nicknames, from definitely from backbiting, from slandering, from namima, which is casting aspersions and innuendo. It is very important for us to change our ways of behavior and to stand up against this anytime we see it. So not only must we not do it, we must also stop other people from doing the same.